Yeah, hi everyone. So in this video, I want to show you some computational resources that you might find helpful for your later homeworks, but also for your class project, where you can use a GPU for free to accelerate the training of certain neural networks. So with that, let me minimize this screen and then show you hands-on how we would do that. Yeah, to start with, I found this very nice GitHub repository called Deep Learning in the Cloud. I will share the link with you. And here the contributors and maintainers put together a really nice list of all the different tools that are available for training deep neural networks in the cloud. So most of them also support GPUs, because that's the whole point. So it's like for cloud GPUs. And yeah, not all of them are free. But here the most popular ones, as far as I know, most people, when they use free cloud GPUs, they use either Google Colab or Kaggle kernels. Both of them are free. There are some limits though in terms of the runtime. I think you can only use one GPU and it resets after 12 hours. But it's still nice to have an option here to use free services, especially as a student. We have the CHTC on campus, which is a high performing computer cluster. However, this would require, I think, more like more experience from your side. Like, it would be more something for later research projects. If you don't have experience with Linux yet, it might be a very steep learning curve in addition to everything we use in the class here in our lecture class. So in that way, I think to get going, if you're new to everything, these are definitely more beginner friendly. All right, so here is a lot of options. Some of them have a fixed number of free hours, or they give you a startup credit, for example, free $300 of credit for these types of things. And at the bottom, I also wanted to mention there is, I think, there's more stuff. So also, especially for students, there are some extra special offers, which are also super nice. So for simplicity, I will walk you through Google Colab, how we can use Google Colab for a project. So let me click on this, and then it should open up a new notebook here. So notice that this is a notebook environment. It's a blessing and a curse. Notebook environments are easy to use, and what's nice is you can also see the results in there. But as code becomes more complicated, sometimes a cloud environment would be also nice where you have Python scripts. But yeah, you can explore the list and see what's best suited for you. Ultimately, it's really up to you what you want to use for your class projects. So there's no requirement using one environment over the other. It's really up to you. Because this is relatively beginner friendly, let me cover this one here. So one important thing, if you want to use this, is to actually select a GPU to make it available. For that, you have to go to runtime and then change runtime type, and then choose GPU. You can also use TPUs, but I recommend for this class to use GPUs. All right, so, and then we can check if PyTorch is available. So let me type import torch, and then torch.version, just to see, I don't know why it's so slow. It's loading 1.7, which is a recent one, which is nice. And also, I think this is like a Google specific thing, because usually that is something that doesn't show up when you import Torch on your normal computer. I think this just means that it has CUDA 10.1 support. Also, just to make sure that it indeed recognizes the GPU. CUDA is available. So just to make sure, so it shows true. For example, let me just try this. If the GPU is not available, it should return, or did I save this? It should return false. Yep, so if you see false, make sure you have GPU checked here. All right. Now, what we can do is we can open notebooks. So we can, for example, add a new notebook. So it's a new window here, okay. There might be also, that's what I wanted to know. Open a notebook, so you can actually open notebooks directly from GitHub. So for example, you could technically go to our class repository here, and then let's choose what we covered last on Tuesday. So the add a line with AutoGrad and PyTorch. Let's use that one. So I'm opening that here, and I'm copying it, and then I can directly have the link here, so which is very nice. So I can, I need to search it first. Yeah, I can directly open it. Okay, I think I just can click on it. No, stay on page. This was not the right one. Okay. Yeah, let me try this again. I think I need to click this one. Open notebook, a new tab. Okay, sounds good. So yeah, here we have now our code. So I can choose the runtime, the GPU, and then we can actually run it, right? So let's do it. Watermark, this didn't work. Oh, okay. So this is a warning message because it's a notebook, not from Google. Just like a warning, let's say run anyway. Okay, so we get an error. What is the error? Module watermark has not been found. So this is because Google Colab comes with some packages pre-installed, but of course it doesn't have every possible Python package pre-installed, so some packages we have to install ourselves. It's actually not too complicated. We can just use this exclamation mark, which is a terminal command for executing a bash terminal command. So we can run, for example, pip install. So pip install watermark, and then it should install it. Yep, so it's loading it and then successfully installed, and then this should work. Right, this works. So this is just a general way of how you can install packages. Then if you have packages that are not already installed in Google Colab. Okay, moving on. Loading Torch, or PyTorch. Now loading our dataset. Oops, another problem. So yeah, the thing is we loaded the notebook, but we didn't load the data, right? So if I go back here to the repository, there's this datasets subfolder with an iris dataset, which this notebook doesn't know about because the link is this one here. So how can it know where to load the data from? I mean, one way would be for CSV files to just copy the link here. This should work, I guess. It's loading because pandas can load directly from CSV files, so this worked. So I can just show you that xtrain should be loaded. But usually in practice, consider a case where you have a data set that is not on GitHub, that is maybe on your computer, and it's also not a CSV file. So you want to have a more general solution. So how can you do that? For that, you have to mount your Google Drive folder. So this is a little bit complicated. I have already actually put together some slides that I will share with you after recording this video. So assume we have this data set locally. Let's download this here. So I'm downloading it right now. So then I'm opening it here. And then let me go to my Google Drive. So I have a Google Drive folder here, my drive, and then I have a subfolder Colab notebooks. This should be originally or automatically generated. Actually, let me save this notebook. So it says cannot save changes. And this is because we don't have permission for saving it yet, so we have to make a copy. So it means basically it's loaded directly from GitHub. It doesn't allow us to overwrite the GitHub repository, which makes sense. So let's make a copy of this in our Google Drive. It's completed. Okay, new tab. So this is our copy of Adeline. If I load this directory now, or if I refresh this Google Colab, you will see here, this is now in my Colab notebooks folder. So you can also directly go here if you have code on your computer and just drag and drop it here. And then you can go right click, open with Google Collaboratory. That is also a way to do that. Now, assume I have my data set that I want to connect with my notebook. So let's say I have a data set here on my hard drive or whole data set folder. I can just take that and also drag and drop that here. So it's now datasets. So it's the same structure as shown here. So it's next to my notebook. So let's see if we can load it now. Too many sessions. Okay, let me close this one and this one. Okay, there are still too many sessions. Okay, let me terminate this one and this one. And maybe also this one. All right. Let's try again. Okay, now it works. Okay. So technically, we might think, okay, we can load the data now because it is relative to our notebook here in this dataset subfolder. So it's located here, right? However, in practice, there's still a file not found error. And this is because, yeah, that's like a little quirk. We have to mount our Google Drive to or into this notebook. So how we do that, if I recall, it's from google.colab import mount, and then, oh no, sorry, drive. I think it's, sorry, from Google import drive, and then drive.mount, and then let me just look this up because I've actually made that in my slides just to make sure I type the right thing here. Okay, mount content and drive. Interesting. Okay, so from google.colab import drive and then mount content drive. I will share the slides with you after this video. So we can do this. Then it asks us to enter an authorization code, which we can do by following this link. Let me just confirm this. Yep. Then I can copy this, enter it here. All right, this is my authorization code. Now it should be mounted. Take some time. Okay, so now it should work. So let me load the data. Still a file not found. Okay, so the reason is we have now mounted this drive, but it is it requires a little bit more information about that, because the notebook, you can think of it, it sits in some arbitrary place on a Google server, and this data set sits on my Google Drive. So you have to be a little bit more specific and provide a concrete address. So it would be, let's see, content drive, my drive, and then colab notebooks. So this is essentially, if you follow here, my drive, Google Colab notebooks, and then data sets. So this is what we have here now. So this should now work. So yep, this finally worked. It seems a little bit complicated, but technically it's not that complicated. I showed you a lot of things that don't work to motivate or to do it here step by step. But technically you can also just leave these lines in your notebook and then it should work. So you only have to do it once if you, and then for the next project you can copy and paste it. But there is also one little addition I want to make, and that is there are two computers involved here right now, or at least two servers. One is Google Drive, where your data set is sitting, and one is this notebook that is running on a different computer instance at Google. And the communication between those computers can be a little bit slow because it goes over the internet. So to speed things up when we work with more complicated data sets, it's actually better to copy this data to the same computer that is running this notebook. So for example, what you could do is you can do an a copy. So you can say copy tree. So you can copy, oops, yeah, that's what I want. You can copy these data sets here to a local folder called datasets. So you copied it, and then you can again use the original link. And if you have large data sets, the training will be faster when we use PyTorch data loaders if the data set is located locally like that. So here I just copied it from Google Drive to this local directory called datasets. So this is what I would recommend. And even further than that, I would actually recommend, if you have more complicated data sets, to make a zip file. So Yeah, for example, in my case, I could just go here, compress datasets. Now I have this datasets.zip file, and then I go to this folder here and drag and drop it here. So it's now datasets.zip. And then I go here, and instead of copy tree, because it's a single file, I will just copy datasets.zip to, yeah, just datasets.zip. So I'm just copying it here. And then I can unzip it, unzip datasets.zip. Oops, I need an exclamation mark because this is not a Python command, this is a bash terminal command. And it asks me to overwrite this because I already have a dataset like this in my drive. So yeah, this should work now, okay. So this should then also work. In that way, this is my recommended way, using the zip file and then unzip it on this machine. Of course, for something simple like Iris, it's overkill, but later we will see, we will be working with data loaders and, for example, large image data sets like MNIST, where you have 50,000 images, and it is just faster to upload or copy a single file and then unpack it compared to uploading 50,000 files, like small little files. So in this way, it's like my recommended approach if you use Google Colab. All right, so this is, yeah, then how you use the GPU. Actually, we haven't used the GPU in this notebook here yet, just to quickly continue. So if you wanted to use the GPU, you have to do one additional step. You have to torch device use the GPU, actually. So there's only one GPU in this computer. So we use the index 0, which stands for the first GPU. This one would be the second GPU, third GPU, fourth GPU, and so forth. Here's only one GPU. So we can just, oops, transfer it to the one GPU. Okay. So one issue is this is our manual implementation. So this, of course, doesn't support the GPU because it's not using the model class. So let me, yeah, I'm doing this very spontaneously here. Let me run this regularly and then go to the automatic one. So order line automatically. This is the one using module. So if you do that, then this one will technically support the GPU. So we do this one and then it should run on the GPU. We have to make one more modification for the training data set, I assume. We'll see if that runs. All right. So yeah, see, it says some argument is on the CPU while it's expected to be on the GPU. So that is because we also have to do the same thing for the data set. So let me see. I assume we can simply do the same thing for this one and this one. Let me make a typo here. One missing here. Yeah, so now it works. So I also transferred the data to the GPU. If you have the model on the GPU, it also expects the data to be on the GPU. So in the later code examples, I will have a flag to do this more automatically, where you only have at the top of the script, where you only have to specify it once, and then it will automatically update it everywhere where you wanted to use the correct device. All right, so yeah, that is just a quick tutorial how to use the GPU. I have also these slides here for the Google Colab, and I will also upload them. So I hope that was useful, and let me know if you have any questions.